What's up, everybody? All right, so let's go. So my last couple times I tried to make this video, I didn't prepare myself well. I had the information, but I didn't really plan on how I was going to present it. You know, you gotta kind of think of it like an oral presentation, like high school or college. You might have to, you might have all the necessary information with you, but unless you present it in a correct way in order for it to make sense, it's useless. So I'm one of those people who needs the information to sit for a while, you know? Like, you gotta kind of think of it like using a marinade. Like, the longer you let the meat sit in the marinade, the longer those flavors have to absorb into the meat, and, you know, like, the better it's gonna taste. So I know a lot of you don't understand the meaning behind this video. Just understand that this isn't made in, I guess you could say, blatant malice. I don't know if that's the right words to use. Just know that there is reason behind this. You know, over the final months of 2016, you know, I've noticed and seen in several forms on various social media sites, including my own Facebook timeline, my own YouTube videos underneath the comments, and on my Twitter mention, that there's like a severe lack of respect going into 2017 and in the coming years, you know, now that Trump is in office, you know, and because I've seen the ignorant, stupid, bigoted, racist, disgusting bullshit that I've witnessed with my own eyes, I mean, eventually you're going to feel the need that you got to speak up, you got to say something to, you know, and to all who may watch this, be it a friend of mine's or some random viewer that, just know that what I'm about to say, if it does not apply to you, at least understand why it needs to be said. And another thing I just want to throw out there, you know, I don't know why people thought of this when I first announced I was going to make this video, but I'm not doing this because somebody else did. Matter of fact, I'm doing it because nobody else had the courage to do it. Like, if you're going to do anything, you should do it because you want to do it and you understand it and agree with the reason behind why you want to do it, not because somebody else did it, not just because somebody else did it. You know, that way when someone comes to question you on why you're doing it, which people will, regardless of what it is, you have your reason and your own experience behind why you want to do it, and you can defend yourself with your own reason as opposed to somebody else just, you know, making up reasons. Like, for example, you guys remember a couple years back, let me not say that. If you guys remember, Lil Wayne, he had on those zebra striped jeggings, or like those black and white spotted jeggings at the BET Awards. And then it seemed like after that, all these other dudes started wearing questionable shit that they said that they would never wear. And they was always using Lil Wayne as an excuse as to why they were wearing it. And Young Thug comes out wearing dresses. All of a sudden, these dudes want to start wearing females' clothing, and they don't want to be called cross-dressers. You know what I'm saying? People using what other people doing as a defensive mechanism to defend what they did when there's no reason for them to do it. You know what I mean? It's just people trying to find ways to defend themselves or do something stupid and then try to use a celebrity to try to justify why they're doing it. You know, but that's neither here nor there. I just wanted to make a point. Another thing, I've never been one to fear consequences, so whatever may come my way, and by the way, I'm looking at my screen right now because I'm trying to find the bookmarks that I'm going to use in this video, but yeah, like, I've never been one to fear consequences, so whatever may come my way because of me saying these things, if I lose friends, opportunities, etc., which I shouldn't. But in this world that we live in, you know, lies reign supreme, and the political veil of comfort, you know, that shit reigns supreme. So when you know, so I mean, when you show that you aren't afraid to say what needs to be said, because you understand that the information is bigger than yourself, you know, you don't care who's offended, because the truth needs to be told. So even if it means your own demise, and I don't think it's going to come to that, you know, conclusion, but still, even if it means your own demise, you want to get the truth told. Plus, when you've seen the things that I've seen and you read the things that I've read from some of the most mind-numbing people, all of which were either white people or some bootlicking Uncle Tom, and it's like you have to say something to counter that idiocy. You know, we've been through a lot as a people, and we've been lied to, stolen, forced to have sex with our own family members on breeding farms, because you got to keep the slaves coming, I understand. Stolen inventions from the slaves, and the slave masters took ownership for them. We were beaten, burned alive, hung, sodomized. Yes, look up buck breaking. It did happen. Look it up. Told and treated like we were nothing, and that black people didn't have the right to anything. You beat us into submission to submit to your Christianity. You denied us at every form of literature except the Bible. Dude, I can go on and on and on about this stuff. Like, and then after Emancipation Proclamation, where, you know, slaves were supposedly free, you know, which they really weren't, but, you know, the transfer of slavery just went from the ownership to the state, and you can even go to prison and see a lot of prison documentaries where it's still set up like, you know, those slave times where the slaves are picking cotton and there's a white dude on the back of a horse with a shotgun. It's, you know, it's still happening. It's just that the state owns slavery now, basically. You know, but yeah, even after the Emancipation Proclamation, we still had to deal with our leadership getting lied on, locked up, and killed for reasons only that the United States of America hated niggas and didn't want them to be happy in a happy place unless it was under their tyranny. You know what I mean? So, so anybody who was in place to take out, to take us out of this self-hating slave mentality, you know, they were killed, locked up, or lied on, or more times than not, all of the three. So we were desensitized to violence and bringing harm to our own because of that desensitization. We hate ourselves, which I'm going to touch on a little later, but we end up in a dystopia that is still in effect today, because after slavery, we still had redlining, we had Jim Crow laws, martial laws, systematic influence that prevented us from advancing as a people. Ronald Reagan, which underneath his leadership, pushed drugs into the inner cities where we weren't allowed to leave because of redlining, if you know what that means. Keep the people even more fucked up. Just a bunch of shit like that. And I can go on and on and on, but they won't teach this shit in schools. They not finna do that. But I'm gonna touch on that a little later as well. Because this is the topic of discussion, you know. What is it about oppression that makes white people want to be a part of it so bad? Based on the things that I'm seeing, again, all over social media. And if you feel like this doesn't apply to you, then you shouldn't get offended, but you should still understand why it needs to be said. Why do white people want to feel oppressed so damn bad? You know, it's like a club that nobody wanted to be a part of and nobody was interested in, but it's like we were forced into it. And when I say us, I mean like Native Americans, black people, browns, you can even throw in the Asians in there, you know, because they had fucking camps that they were forced into and shit, you know. But it's like, it's a club that nobody wanted to be forced into, and now after they're beginning to notice that the shit is starting to hit the fan, now all of a sudden they want us to come together and act like we're just one race. Well, if it's a childish mentality of, and I think of it like high school kids, you know, trying to be the cool guy. You know, in high school, kids always thought that, you know, like the bad guy was the cool guy. And, you know, you may see a kid that you may have never seen before and he came from like a dangerous place or he survived, or anybody that survived anything dangerous, seemed like they always gained a certain amount of respect for that person because they survived a bad situation. You know what I mean? And I don't know, I kind of think of it like that in a sense, where it's like a childish mentality, you know. They seen that we survived some bad things, so now they want to be a part of it. You know, I don't know, like, I'm kind of messing myself up, but that's kind of how I think about it when I see these white people on social media and shit. you know, even in person. You know, I see them in person on my way to work and things like that, in the stores and Walmarts and everything. Like, it's crazy. You guys know I don't bring my negativity to the channel because I go through a lot of it. Even though I'm in a better situation now, I still go through it. And there's several things that have happened that I may touch on throughout the course of this video that I just never brought it up. You know what I mean? Because I don't like to bring negativity to the channel, but I feel like, fuck it, man. Let me get it out my system for all the things that I've seen and all the things that I have personally dealt with. You know, it's time to say something. Fuck it. Because, you know, like, enough is enough. So, you know, it's, for them, when I see white people that are trying to feel oppressed, it's laughable. It's like some sense of respect there. And for the first time, this is something that white people literally can't be a part of. This is something that white people cannot be a part of. You know, they just can't be. Because historically, you are put in a position to, you are put in a better position than anybody else, strictly because of the color of your skin, bro. Literally. And it's like the oppressor is trying to feel oppressed. Because even though some white people may say, oh, I was never like that, and I reject that, that's cool, but understand that situations were still made to where things are better for you than anybody else that's considered to be a minority. And for the people who seems like they're following the legacy of their ancestors, the ones that colonized and did all these terrible things to other ethnicities and races, you know what I mean? It's just, they just, it's mind-numbing, bro. And I'm just trying to get through this because I told myself I was going to do this video today and I plan on doing it. But you already know. But from what I'm seeing on social media, it seems like white people are desperately trying to flip the history of black people to fit them. Now, I can't speak for any other ethnicity as far as like the Mexicans and the Native Americans, but I wouldn't be surprised if the same things are happening to them. But for black people, I know I can speak for us. From what I'm seeing, it seems like they're desperately trying to flip the history of black people to fit them. And you can always tell how they always welcome the notion for you to stop talking about racism, but they never put that same effort and energy towards telling a racist to stop being racist. Funny how that works, right? But, you know, what they're trying to do is trying to make you seem like you're the cause of your own problems, which is a lie. At the same time, of them doing what they're trying to at the same time of them doing what they are trying to say, see, I'm getting tongue-tied right now. My brain, this is why I fucked up the last few videos. My brain is trying to process the information way faster than I can speak it. Alright, we good. So, yeah, so at the same time of them doing that, they're trying to sell lies as if they were the ones who were oppressed historically when the shoe clearly doesn't fit, you know. And I'm going to touch on this a little bit later, so don't go nowhere. So, example, a bit of recent history for you. And I noticed this is like the first thing that really caught my attention. After Donald Trump had belittled that CNN reporter, some of you may know the video that I'm talking about. I wish I had it. That's one of the videos that I tried to find and I could not find. But yeah, he belittled that CNN reporter at like a conference or like some type of, you know, like, I can't remember what it was, but it was at some event. So forgive me if I can't remember exactly what it was. Like, some of y'all know what I'm talking about, though. But yeah, he belittled like the CNN reporter. I think he said something about it being like fake news or something like that. He's a fake news reporter. Some disrespectful shit. I can't remember what he said verbatim. That's why I wish I could find that video. And I'm kind of mad I couldn't find it. That's poor scholarship, by the way. But yeah, I noticed that after he did that, it seems like all of a sudden, the people that were defending Trump and saying how great he was, now these motherfuckers want to say shit against Trump. Now everyone who had the common sense not to vote for this dumb dick, well, we're all looking at you from a distance like, really? Like this, now all of a sudden he's wrong? Like he wasn't wrong before when he was encouraging white people at his rallies, these racists at his fucking rallies to physically assault black and brown people. You know what I'm saying? And consistently kick out Muslims just because they were there. You know, you had teenage black kids getting treated like animals, black people getting spat on, punched in the face, Muslims getting thrown out for nothing. And, you know, like he wasn't wrong during any of those times. He wasn't wrong for comments he made towards women. He wasn't wrong when he made fun of that disabled guy. Oh, but because he belittled a CNN reporter, oh, now he's a bad person. Now we need to reevaluate if we made the right decision. Now we need to reevaluate if we made the right choice voting for this guy. And I use that to say this. People with that form of thinking, the ones who never heed warnings beforehand, even when they're blatantly obvious, the ones that wait until the damage gets done and then notice it and then go on rants like nobody said anything before, like nobody forewarned them. And then on top of that, they want to act all passive towards the damage that they purposely turned a blind eye to. And then you have to ask yourself why, you know, when it comes to this, again, going back to why white people want to feel oppressed, then you have to ask yourself, why are you using other people's misfortunes to validate your own? And then, you know, and it's one of those things where it's like, monkey see, monkey do. I don't know, I guess that's the way to use it. But why do people try to use other people's misfortunes to try to validate their own? It's like, that doesn't justify it for you. Necessarily. Another thing, I'm going to continuously keep pausing this video because I got distractions all around me. So forgive me if you hear like background noise and things like that. I'm trying to get people to quiet down while I'm trying to focus on doing this video. But nevertheless, why do other people try to use their misfortunes to validate their own when it clearly doesn't justify it for them? I see like something is on my glasses. What's the shine? Me being stupid. But yeah, it's like, with these white people, it's like they have this idea that if they don't talk about the problem, then the problem goes away, which is understandable because some of them, when they do, it comes off all wrong, and then it comes off fucked up, and they end up doing more harm than good. And then you can always tell how they always tell you to get over slavery. Now, let me go in on this shit. First and foremost, the victimizer has no right to tell the victim how to feel. You know, slavery is our history. You want to act like everybody's American? Slavery is American history. American history is very, very, very fucking dark. And a lot of y'all don't want to admit that. But I'm going to touch on that a little bit later. And, you know, we got a lot of fucking black people leaving when I first announced I was going to make this video. They asked me, oh, you sound angry. I mean, hell yeah, I sound angry. I mean, shit. When you study up on your own history and you leave certain institutions and you start going on your own path to gather information and find out what it is they weren't teaching you, you find out about a lot of shit and you realize you've been lied to for a lot of years, you know what I mean? So when you find this shit out, it's like, and by the way, I'm not finding this out today. I mean, obviously this is like years and years and years, and me trying to be passively accepting all this, you know, I'm just like, fuck it, you know? So hell yeah, I'm angry. Like, I don't get loud and things like that, but you know, anger is a very passionate emotion. You know, when you're angry about something, regardless of what it is, you know, anger is a catalyst for you to want to change what you're angry towards. So anger isn't always a bad thing. For example, you know, you think that blacks that fought for us, that fought on our behalf many years ago, were happy? You know, people always try to use Martin Luther King's name for bullshit. Let's use his name for, you know, some real shit. You know, if you think Martin Luther King wasn't angry at the prejudice and racism he was facing during his time, you know, it was because of that anger he was able to spearhead the civil rights movement. Same thing with Malcolm X, you know. He was angry. Marcus Garvey, he was angry. And I can go on and on and on, you know. And, you know, people end up getting angry at the wrong thing sometimes, you know. Because then you have people like Zoe Saldana. Let me talk about her for a second. and this may be venturing off, but I'm making a point with this. Like I said, it's a method to the madness. But Zoe Saldana, you know, and I'm talking, you know, I'm only bringing this up because you know, earlier I mentioned about I was talking about self-hatred, and for those of you who don't know who Zoe Saldana is, you know, which is now Zoe Perrego, I believe that's her last name, because she's married to Marco Perrego, an Italian white dude, but I'm gonna touch on that a little bit later. I hope I don't forget it. But yeah, it was Zoe Saldana. For those of you who don't know who that actress is, she played Nick Cannon's girlfriend in Drumline. You know, that was like the one movie that she's like absolutely known for, even though she did many more. You know, I'm not no hater, but at the same time, like, you know, we gotta call out bullshit. You know, a few years back, she had an interview. I can't remember what movie she was promoting, but y'all could probably look this up because I just did, and it was actually worse than I remember. I remember when I first watched that video, I can only listen to it for the first few seconds of the interview, because all I remember her saying was that, the only thing I remember her saying is that she don't see color. Yeah, she's one of those black people. She don't see color. Now, the reason why I'm getting on her is because there's like a group of black people out there who don't want to mess up what they have. And it's understandable because, you know, they get it in the back of their head that the money is worth more than them. I get it. I understand. You don't want to mess up what you got. You got some good going on. You're not going to mess up your money talking about these black people problems. Okay. I get it. You know what I mean? Even to the point where you even start to deny who you are and your damn self. But that's just, I'm just making a point here. That's why I'm bringing her up, because she's like the one instance that came to mind. And, you know, they understand very well that the money is bigger than them, so just shut up and just accept it, you know. What was that Harriet Tubman said? You know, I freed 1,000 slaves, and I could have freed 1,000 more if they only knew they were slaves, but nevertheless. When I look back to what, when I look at, see, I'm getting tongue-tied again. When I went back to look at this interview, like I said, it was worse than what I thought. She actually said, and I quote, "People of color don't exist." You know, and I get what she, you know, like I get it. She meant that because she doesn't see because she doesn't see color. You know, people of color doesn't exist. First off, black people that say that they don't see color is like the funniest thing ever, because y'all must run stop signs like a motherfucker. But, you know, you motherfuckers must run red lights constantly. If you don't see color, then it's no fucking way you can be color coordinated and none of that shit. You know what? I don't want to get into that because I could clown them all day on that shit. But it's stupid, you know. And, but you got to understand when you say things like that as a black person, when you say things like you don't see color or people of color doesn't exist, when you say things like that, you're ignoring the prejudice and actions that's been done against you because you are black, which gives leeway to the people who does see that you're black. You know, it gives leeway to them to get away with it even more so than they are now. You know, in an episode, for example, like, let me give you like a point of reference of what I mean, because maybe you'll understand it better if I give you a reference. It was an episode of The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. And you guys know the character Carlton. You know, he was like this preppy black guy, at least during this season. I think it was the first season of the show, where, you know, Carlton, he was this preppy black guy, you know, born into a wealthy family, who never really acknowledged himself or identified himself as black. Like, he never really recognized himself as what he was. So, you know, and it was during that entire first season, I believe, that was his character. But during this episode that I'm referring to, I think Will and Carlton, I think they were driving to or from somewhere, but the cops pulled them over and they started harassing them, basically. And when they got back home, Carlton, you know, being in denial, thought the officer was just doing his job. Some of you know what episode I'm talking about, too. but just completely ignorant to the fact that this cop just did some racial profiling. Like, he either didn't know or just didn't want to believe that there were cops out there like that. You know what I'm saying? But getting back to Zoe, you know, this is a black woman who's just completely in denial of who she is. And it's like a community of black people that are like that. It's not just her, but I'm just using her as a reference to make a point. But what's so funny is that Zoe, back in April of 2016, she played Nina Simone in a movie, Nina. Now, what's interesting is that, for those of you who don't know Nina Simone, she was an activist, she was a jazz singer, R&B singer, she was a soul singer, you know, she was like a well-respected singer who was on film saying that she was proud to be black. She, you know, she was a self-aware black woman, basically. Let me just say that. She was very proud of her race, she was proud of who she was as a black woman. You know, she became an activist, and she was a musician. Like, she had a beautiful voice. But a movie was made about her, and they picked Zoe Saldana to play the role of this woman. And so here we have it. We have a woman in Zoe Saldana who says that she don't see color and that people of color doesn't exist, but they handpick her to play a movie, but to play a role in a movie dedicated to a proud black woman who understood who she was, who was a respected musician and singer amongst her peers, and her music is still revered to this day, to those who know of her legacy. But I get it. Like, you put black people in a dystopia, then you put the desensitized black people in the forefront, because then the black community will blame the black person instead of the white people who caused that condition to begin with. I get it. Y'all not slick. But it's like, I don't know what to put it. It's almost like an advanced form of, I want to say, Stockholm Syndrome, where the victim is defending their victimizers, even though it's not like that. Like, I kind of look at it like that, though. It's like, to the point where you're completely ignoring who you are and blaming yourself for your own misfortune and ignorant to the history that put us in this mental state to begin with. It's like you're defending your historical oppressors while denying who you are as a person. You know, Stacey Dash found that out the hard way. And I can get on her for days. Her shit is like 10 videos within itself. But let me, like, I'm going to have to pause the video because I can't like flip the camera or nothing like that right now. Alright, so this is the movie I was talking about, like Nina. Like, this is the movie. Like, you guys probably can't see the poster that well. Now, I want you to take a good look at Zoe Saldana. Just take a good look at her. You know, she has light brown skin. You know, she's a black woman. You know, light brown skin. You know, looks beautiful. You know, and what have you. Now, remember what I said about her saying that she don't see color and shit like that. You know, in the way that she said it, she seemed like she was trying to be so careful not to step on any toes and shit like that. But this is her, you know, normal, you know, black woman. You know, she's like light, she has like a light brown skin tone. You know what I'm saying? She looks beautiful. You know what I'm saying? But now, to a woman, again, who does not understand her own fucking identity, they end up picking these people to play some of the roles that they shouldn't be qualified to play. But I understand what it is. It's a tactic to try to distract black people from what the real problem is, and they use it. They just used her as like a bait, tactic, basically. But it's still wrong what she did, and I'm going to talk about it. Now, again, this is a woman, you know, and I'm referring to Zoe, who was on record, on video, actually. You guys, again, if you look it up, you guys can probably find the video. But she went on record saying that she doesn't see color and that people of color don't exist to her. So why would they pick her to play a role in a movie of a woman who is proud to be a black woman and knows who she is? And would never see anything like that. So we have her, you know, looking normal right now. And, you know, light brown skin or whatever the case is, you know what I'm saying? But when she played the role of Nina Simone, now, again, I want you to take a look at her skin right now. Again, going back to her. This is a black woman now. A black woman deciding that she wanted to play the role of Nina Simone. You know, and they put her, you know, light brown skin, black woman. Okay. You know, she could have played the role of Nina Simone without doing this shit. Now, clearly, you see what the fuck's going on here. My question to you is, how in the fuck does a black woman do blackface playing a role of another black woman? And this shit right here, this is why it's important for you to value who you are as black people. And I'm speaking to my black people right now. Because when you get so desensitized to the point where you start doing shit like this, and you don't see what the problem... Oh, and to this day, by the way, she never understood what the problem was for her doing this, by the way. Like, you're so detached from the bullshit that we had to endure that you end up doing silly shit like this, and then you could just be used as a puppet to be put... You know, like, you're basically being used as, like, a body shield. You know what I mean? And all the shots that black people are sending towards racism and you know, things alike, you're taking all those hits for them. Because when you do things like this, it's like, we never expected a black person to do shit like this. Like, how the fuck are you a black woman and then you playing the role of a proud black woman when you yourself say that you don't see color and you don't want to, you know what I'm saying, people of color don't exist to you, but then all of a sudden you go and do blackface and then wonder why the hell people are mad at you for doing that. You know what I'm saying? This was a respected activist. And again, like, you can look at her regular pictures. You know, she has light brown skin, Zoe. But then she want to fucking go and paint her face black. Like, how does a black woman go blackface portraying a black woman? Like, how in the fuck? And there's a side picture. Like, look at this shit. And it's not the lighting. You know, I'm trying to... Can I turn the brightness up? No, it still doesn't make no fucking difference. But yeah, bro, it's like, really, like, you can't make this shit up. like you really just gotta sit back and you gotta laugh at it, because you wonder, how the fuck does a black woman do blackface playing a role of a black woman? Like, how disrespectful do the fuck you have to be to not even understand what blackface was? To where you are okay as a black woman to do, you know what, let me just leave that shit alone, because I'm, you know, you can go on for days on this one, but it's a legion of black women out there, and black men, or just a legion of, like, a nice percentage of black people that do that type of shit, that don't really know the damage that they are doing when they do stupid shit like this, and it's sad to see that a black woman would do this, or any black person would do this type of shit. You know, it's just, it's sad. But anyways, back to the topic. You know, they can talk about history all they want. You know, they do it in school systems and courts, etc. And they pick out the parts that they want left out. And the history in America, again, like I mentioned earlier, is a very, very dark one. And I mean very dark. They quick to tell you about the wars that they won, and the dumbasses in the southern states, I'm from Louisiana, they still do this shit. They, you know, they fly a flag from a defeated company, from a war to try to, that's used to justify their racism. They try to disguise it as patriotism and southern pride and shit, but we know better. For the ones who went through this shit, we know better. You know, you try to get a job down there, you got all the qualifications, and then you all of a sudden, they won't hire you because, you know, they say, oh, you're unqualified. You know what I'm saying? Like, little dumb shit like that. It's like, unless you're kissing her, it's so blatant down there, and I know my people down in Louisiana that know me, I know y'all still going through it, and I know it is. Like, I know y'all are. It's not a secret, because I see y'all on y'all timeline. And most of y'all are friends on my Facebook, you know, and it's like, I see y'all on the timeline, y'all always complaining about how unfair y'all getting treated. Like, we know what the fuck it is. Like, we know what the fuck it is. Like, we ain't even gotta go any deeper into that, you know. But, you know, they skim over all that evil shit that has happened to Native Americans, Negroes, and Mexicans, and they will give you just, like, little tidbits just to say that they talked about it, but it's the bare minimum. You know what I mean? And the way that they even talk about it, the way they even talk about that bare minimum is bullshit, because they don't really want to talk about it. So they just touch on it a little bit, like, you know, they just give it a couple taps, and then they just don't say shit anyway, you know, any more other than that. But yeah, because if they talked about it the way that it needs to be, then it would be understood why blacks, browns, and reds, more so blacks and browns, are in the state of mind that they're in these days. Like, you block us from moving into your burbs, you redline us, you know, Jim Crow laws, martial law, systematic racism. You know, we couldn't join your boy and girl, like your Boy Scout and your Girl Scout programs. You know, we systematically denied wealth. So, yeah, the system has always been against us, you know. And to this day, they force us, you know, into the inner city. You know, they forced us into the inner cities. Excuse me. And like, mouth getting kind of dry, but yeah. And anytime black, brown, or Native Americans, but specifically blacks, because that's what I'm talking about, tried to make themselves feel as if they were worth something. The moment we had any black leadership that, you know, I spoke on this earlier, the moment that we had any black leadership that could have and was taking us out of that slave, self-hating mentality, those people got killed and locked up for lengthy periods where, so like, one to two generations pass and they barely know who they are, let alone respect what they did, even though they were probably taught about them, you know. And so we're in such a dystopia, and we are still going through it today. You know, police are having open season, especially last year, 2016. My God, man, police trigger happy than a motherfucker. But what about black on black crime? Because I know y'all gonna say some shit about that. Now, you probably heard before that black on black crime is a myth. Here's why they say that. When you say the phrase black on black crime, that is a falsehood, just like white Jesus. Yes, I said white Jesus. He's a falsehood. If you read Revelations 1 and 15 to the 16th verse, it completely describes Jesus Christ as being black. I'm not going to go no further than that, but black on black crime is a falsehood that has been used in such a political manner, just like white Jesus, that you cannot imagine anything else being that, even when the truth speaks otherwise. You know, what I'm talking about is black-on-black crime is a falsehood, because it paints a picture that only black people are doing this to their own kind, even though the FBI, you know, put out reports that white people commit crimes against their own at pretty much the same rate as every other ethnicity, or more so blacks, but you know what I'm saying? They commit crimes at the same rate against their own, because anytime you're in a community with your own people, you're more likely to do crimes against them. But anytime you hear, oh, this race against this race crime, it's always black on black crime. Like, they always advertise black on black crime, and the falsehood that paints is the bullshit that I'm talking about. But you can't expect some people to know that. You know, you can't ask a historically destructive people to be constructive. You know, you can't be surprised at them reacting to what I'm saying, because most of them refuse to learn their own fucking history. You know, it's fact. Most of them refuse to learn their own fucking history. And if your history was rooted in thievery and genocide, but all you were taught were the stories of glory and valor, you know, and grew up knowing only that, then it's understandable why you would want to defend what I'm speaking against. You know what I mean? Because you don't even understand what it is that I'm speaking against in its entirety, You just know that, oh, he said white people, so he must be talking about all white people, even though I put the disclaimers in like the first 5 minutes of the damn video. Nevertheless, you know, a lie will always sound better than the truth when more people tell it. You know, despite the fact that you don't even know the facts. But so when someone brings this type of information to you, of course your first instinct is to reject it, because you never, you know, knew it existed, let alone try to study it. To this day, I meet white people who, you know, just in the stores, just anywhere, even primarily on social media, who act as if they never heard about this type of shit happening to black people. So they're not even trying to put this type of shit in like school books. It's, if anything, it's to the point where they're trying to erase slavery and genocide from the history books. And I've seen several, I wish I could have saved that freaking picture. Again, poor scholarship. I should have had it ready for you guys, but I couldn't find it because I was looking. But it was a picture where a student, they had took a picture of like some type of quiz on history, and the question was, why were there slaves? And they gave four, you know, it was a multiple choice answer, A, B, C, D. And if I can remember what was being said, I could quote it. But all the answers that they gave were bullshit. None of them were the true answer as to why slavery actually happened. You know, I think one of the answers were like, oh, because they needed more workers, but because, you know, black people were willing to work for free. Or, you know, just like, it was like four dumbass answers that didn't have anything to do, you know, like the right answer wasn't up there. And then you think about what the teacher would have to deal with. Oh, so, oh, well, just pick what you think is the right answer. You know what I'm saying? They're forcing you to accept lies, that type of shit right there. That's why the school system is so fucked up. But, you know, they're trying to erase slavery from the fucking history books, man. And they even had a book, now that I think about it. It was called A Birthday Cake for George Washington. And that book had caught a lot of heat, for those of y'all who don't know what I'm saying, because that's a children's book. And it was a book where they tried to make the slaves out to be, like, happy in their misery, kind of. Kind of ignoring the fact that they were in misery, and they were like, oh, these slaves are happy to make a cake for George Washington. You know what I'm saying? Like, trying to paint this falsehood that the slaves were happy, and they're doing this to kids. Now, you notice anytime something new gets introduced, regardless what it is, they never target the current generation, because they know that we know better, or rather we should, but that's the way the companies think. They always target the next generation who doesn't know any better. You know what I'm saying? They always do that. Think about it. Now, that's why it's called Young and Dumb. Now, let me give you an example, because I always try to give examples as to why I'm saying the things that I'm saying. These days, like, I want you to think about a bag of chips. Like, how much does a bag of chips cost? You know, these days. Like, how much does a bag of chips cost these days? Like, $1, like $1.50. You know, in that money, you know, like, it's nothing, right? Like, it's $1, right? It's nothing. Like, it's $1, $1.50. Like, what is that? You know what I'm saying? Ask your elders how much a bag of chips cost when they were little. And I even looked this up. Bag of chips were like 5 cents to 15 cents, depending on the size of the bag. And all, of course, depending on the company that sold it. But you had bag of chips that were like 5 cents. That was like the cheapest bag of that you can get. And these were big bags. The bag of chips that would cost us like $1.50, like $1.75 today, were like 5, possibly 10 cents at the most. But 5 more than likely. And these were like big bags of chips that were filled all the way. Of course, they had small bags, but the big bag of chips, you know, they were like 15 cents, but they were filled all the way to the top. Now, you compare that to what we get today, for those of you, especially the ones up in New York, because I see pictures on my Facebook timeline of the people from New York. They go buy a bag of chips, and literally the bag of chips are like full of air, and it's only like 3 chips in the bag. I promise you, I see that a lot. I seen that a lot last year, and I'm starting to see it a little bit more this year. I don't know if they just stopped buying chips from that place that they were getting them, but yeah, it's like that in some places. So, but you know, even with that, like, I want you to compare that to now, like 5 cents for a big bag of chips that's filled all the way to the top versus $1 for possibly the same size that's only half full, if that, because of what some people are telling you, you know. But of course, you don't think you're getting jacked because you grew up in an environment where paying $1 or $1.50 for a bag of chips is normal. Now take that same concept and apply that to self-worth. it's a generation growing up thinking that self-hatred is normal. And that all stems from history. You know what I'm saying? Those who don't learn from history are doomed to repeat it. And the reason why they're trying to take slavery and genocide out of the history books, because they know it's a generation that's going to grow up not knowing about that. And they know once a generation comes up that's completely oblivious to that, then they're just going to, you know, end it. You know, when I say end it, I mean, like, they could just stop trying to talk about history and then just do whatever the fuck they plan on doing. You know, it's like that, man. But, of course, you know, we can do our part and get our own black-owned schools and places that they're going to continue to push. We can get our own black-owned schools and places. Until we do, like, they're going to continue to push out generation of kids who don't know, because the school system is only giving out the bare minimum, and I already talked about that. And funny thing, I mention it now, we did at one point in history have our own, you know, black-owned hospitals, schools, bank, etc. Some of you may have heard of Black Wall Street, and everything there was black-owned. From what I was studying, everything was black-owned there. It was in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And there was a riot there that happened between, it began on May 31st, it ended on June 1st. So it was literally like pretty much for like a full day, it seems like. But it happened in the year of 1921. And basically the way the shit happened was that there was a lie spread that a white woman was raped by a black man from the town of Tulsa, Oklahoma. And there was this massive riot caused by white people. And it was so bad that the United States government actually bombed the entire city. Like, they literally bombed the city. And, you know, between, you know, Black Panthers being assassinated and killed, MLK, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, all these people, all these black leaders, Marcus Garvey, you know, like, we can go down the fucking line of black leadership. You know, we finally get our own place, and then it's like, you know, we can't have shit. So, yeah, so to the white people that voted for Donald Trump, I mean, I can't end this without going in on this. Like, the hatred y'all have for Negroes, Mexicans, and Native Americans is coming back to bite y'all in the ass because of oppression. We survived all that shit, which doesn't, you know, that which don't kill you makes you stronger, right? So for us, like, the struggle is normal. Like, which we should not have had to experience, but since we did, we took what we can, knowing that one day, you know, that shit was gonna bite y'all in the ass. And these are just the early nibbles to let you know that the teeth are about to sink in. So we were built for the struggle. We know how to survive, you know. And for these white people, it seems like they can't even get themselves out of a fucking simple situation. Matter of fact, let me show you an example of this. So I'm going to play this video for you guys. Now, what's about to happen is, this white lady decided she was gonna, I don't know what she was doing. I guess she was just having fun or whatever. But look at this. Now, she kicked her leg up, right? And she got her foot stuck in the damn ceiling. Now, hold on a second. Right there. You see, she got her foot stuck. Now, before I continue going with the video, right? How do you think she got her foot down? Like, how do you think she got her foot down? Or more rather, how would you have gotten your foot down if you was in this situation? You know, I'm gonna let you think for a minute. All right, I'm gonna continue playing this so you can see it for yourself. I see how she's trying to get her own foot down and shit. I'm just trying to. Alright, now look at this. This dude is trying to use a chisel to try to hammer her foot out. Now, why in the fuck is he using a goddamn chisel to try to hammer out her fucking foot? And it got so bad that they left her there overnight. I'm pretty sure they got her fucking foot out. But that's just one thing that I'm talking about, man. And not only that, you know, again, going back to what I'm saying about white people starting to regret their decision, I want you to take a look at all these white folks right here. All these people that voted for Trump, because I'm pretty sure you can't see some of the pictures. Some of them may not be, you know what I'm saying, white and shit, but still, the people that voted for Donald Trump, like, look at all this. All of them, all these motherfuckers just starting to regret their fucking decision. Like I said, it's coming back to bite them in the ass, and it's coming back to bite them in the ass in a bad way. You know, as a Hispanic woman that voted for you, you're stupid. You're stupid. You're stupid. Like I said, I knew all of them wasn't white. Yeah, you see them. It's everywhere. Regretting for voting for Donald Trump. We told your dumbass, stop, don't vote for this man. But of course, they didn't listen. And this was another guy that I found, another thing I found, where, mind you, these were taken like 1 week from each other. Now look at the dates. One was 1/14/2017, and the other one was 1/23/2017. So on January 14th, you know, he's telling Obama, okay, just leave already. Literally a week later, when fucking Donald Trump got in office, he started doing all this stupid shit. This is what he said. I voted for you and supported you, and now you're freezing government pay. What the hell is wrong with you? I won't vote for you again. He said, wow, pay freeze. I'm a GS employee. I work hard. I wish I would have never voted for you. I have a family, Trump. Unbelievable. I'm pretty sure that's what he meant. I have a family. I'm pretty sure he didn't mean to typo that S. But, yeah, going back to what I'm saying, you know what I'm saying? And y'all know y'all fucked up. Y'all know y'all fucked up. And let me, you know, historically, like, everything y'all have, y'all stole from other ethnic communities, man. And it's coming back to haunt you. It's like that one kid that bullied everybody in school and never learned his or her lesson, but now wants the people that he bullied to help him out later on in life, and they're just like, nah, we're not going to do it. And rightfully so. You know, so to end it off, man, historically, like, white people, as well as presently and in the foreseeable future, will always burn down a house without knowing they are inside burning with everyone else. And they fuck up the world, and then after the damage is done, they want to act like we need to come together and fix things. And now that I think about it, I got a perfect example for this. Hold on. Let me see, because I should have had this up too. Let me see if I can find that, because this is a perfect example. This is perfect for this. Perfect. Just give me a second, because this is one of those bookmarks I was looking for earlier. Where is it? Right here. Now, I'm going to pause this video. Let's see if I can speed this video up a little bit. Matter of fact, right here. Let me flip this camera around so you guys can see what I'm seeing. Now, if you guys remember, last year, you know, during the campaign of Donald Trump, there was an incident at one of his rallies. Well, not even an incident. It was like a bullshit situation at one of his rallies where this guy, like, his name is King Jones. He was walking out of the stadium where the rally was, and this guy, he had, you know, took it upon himself to just punch the guy in the face. Like he just punched him in the face. And you may remember him because he actually turned to the camera and made a statement and said that if we see him again, we might have to kill him. Yeah, so now some of y'all may be remembering what I'm talking about. I can't remember what this guy's name is. Hold on one second, 'cause I got my headset on, so let me see. John McGraw. His name is John McGraw, and a black dude's name is King Jones. Now, again, like, remember what I said about white people always, you know, historically, they've done this. They've always fucked up, did the damage, and then wanted everybody to come together and act like, you know, we gonna come together and fix this problem. Like, no, it's not gonna happen. Because y'all motherfuckers voted for Trump, so y'all gotta deal with this shit. But the funny thing is, and this is what I wanted to talk about, right over here, right underneath the cheapo air advertisement, the guy, you know, you see the black guy hugging him, because, you know, George McGraw, that was his name? Oh, hopefully I got his name right. I don't want to get nobody's name wrong. I think his name was George McGraw. No, John McGraw. That's what it was. Hold on, I'm trying to rewind that video. Yeah, John McGraw. Okay. So, in court, right, which, matter of fact, let me click on the video, because I think this is important. Hopefully I don't get copyrighted for it, because I'm trying to make a point. Let me see. Now, I want you to pay a good close attention to the face of King Jones and John McGraw. Now, watch this. Now, John McGraw was charged, you know, with assault and battery, but I think they only gave him house arrest for the physical assault, you know, and which is bullshit. We all know it is bullshit. And I don't want to play the video any longer because, like, I may get copyrighted. I'll probably get copyrighted for even having it in the thing. But you can, if you go and you watch this video yourself, you know, that's the name of it right there, Trump supporter, comma, man, he sucker punched in Fayetteville, rally hug in court, and vow to hear America. I remember when they showed this on TV, but I'm glad I was able to find it. But John McGraw, the guy who sucker punched King Jones. Now, throughout this entire video, just pay attention to King Jones' face. Now, white people, you may not understand what's going on. Black people, we understand it. You know, all you got to do is just look at the black guy's face. We understand. We understand that it was, you know, it was bullshit what happened to him. It was bullshit the sentence that John McGraw got. It was just some dumbass shit. So when John McGraw, you know, got sentenced, he turned to King Jones and he told him that this country is in a political mess and it's up to you and I to fix it. So they shake hands and they hug. Now, of course, King Jones, you know, he took the high road, you know, I guess good for him. You know, most of us black people, obviously we know what the fuck is up. Like we know what he really wanted to do. Like we understand. Like, after the sentence, you can look at the dude's face and you can tell by his body language he wasn't, you know, like he wasn't feeling that shit. Really. He really wasn't. Because when a man sucker punches you out of a racist-ass rally, and then turns to a camera and said that he's going to kill you, the last thing you're thinking about doing is shake hands. But I understand he tried to save face for the sake of the fact that he was in court. He wasn't trying to turn up and say anything. So it's understandable. Like, I get it. Like, he ain't want to cause no ruckus. But the nerve of this man to sit there and say, like, I don't even know if he apologized, because in the video, I don't remember him apologizing. I'm talking about John McGraw to King Jones. I don't think he apologized to him. He just said that this country is in a political mess and it's up to you and I to fix it. Now, of course, we can always, you know, assume, because the media does like to chop things up. Like, we ain't gonna, you know, give them no slack on that. They like to chop certain videos up and make you see only what they want you to see. So maybe he did apologize to him. All I'm saying is that it wasn't shown in video. So from my perspective, he didn't do it. But the fact that you sit here and say things like that when you voted a man in office and attended rallies, not only that, but committed an act that was fueled and encouraged by hatred. Like, dude, we can go in and in, but it's the nerve of you to say that we need to come together and fix this shit. Like, get the fuck out of here. I didn't vote for this dickhead to get in office. You did. And on top of that, didn't he say he was going to pay for this man's legal fees? Like he said, anybody who does, I don't know, like Donald Trump said he was going to pay for legal fees and shit like that. And he never did it, of course, because, you know, black folks, we knew what the fuck was up. And, you know, other white people that didn't vote for Donald Trump, they knew what was up. But dumbasses like him fell for it and just like, fuck it, I can do whatever I want. So it is what it is. So yeah, man, it's one of those things where, you know, you realize people were systematically put in a dystopia to where they couldn't thrive, you know. And one last thing I want to touch on, you know, there's a lot of self-hate going on, excuse me, in the black community. And again, I went down a list of reasons why it's there. But black women, I want you to understand that don't fall for like the European standard. You are the original standard for beauty. If you don't believe me, I want to show you this. You know, don't know if I can get a good look at it. Yeah, these are what's called Rococo fashion dresses. These are from the 18th century. This was from the Victorian era. And you can tell by the way the dresses were designed that they were mimicking black women. Because at this time, white women, they weren't known to have curves. They weren't known to have curves. Of course, you may have one or two, you know, white women. I mean, because you can't completely rule out the fact that no white women didn't have, you know, some meat on their bones. But back then, it was desirable for a man to want a woman who was, you know, thin, basically like an ironing board, I guess, if you want to really put it in words, basically like ironing boards. But this was back, let me see if I can find it, it was from the 1650s into the 1800s, let's see if I can find this page, right here, they say, during this period, a new silhouette for women were developed. Now, again, at this time, women weren't thick. White women weren't thick like they are. White women still aren't thick. They just wear yoga pants and trying to pass it off like they're trying to show off their curves and their buns a little bit more, wearing skin tight clothes. Like, I see what y'all doing. Y'all ain't slick. But yeah, during this time, white women were a lot thinner, you know, and black women were mocked and made fun of, you know, they put them in freak shows and say, hey, look at this woman with the big, you know, hips and the big booty and things, you know what I'm saying? They were ridiculed, but the whole time they were doing that, they were sitting here and they were mocking your silhouette in these dresses, you know, because they didn't just develop this silhouette out of no fucking way. Like, I don't know if you guys can really see that. Can you see? Like, this is why I wish I had the camera turned around. You guys probably can't see it that good. Yeah, probably right there. But you can clearly tell this is inspired from black women. And I could be wrong. I am still studying it. But from everything I'm reading, you know, because I didn't want to read everything I had, they were mimicking the silhouette of the black women of that time, because there was no reason for a woman to have a dress this damn big. You know, y'all can say that it was looking elegant and all that other shit, but nah, you put two and two together. If the women back there were thin and men desired thin women, why was the silhouette modeled after black women of that time that they made fun of? You know, you're the original standard for beauty. And I could go deeper into this, but I didn't want the video to be that damn long. I just wanted to respond to the negativity that I'm seeing and that I've dealt with. You know, since I've been to California, I've been called a nigger by white people a total of three times. Like I said, I don't bring my negativity to the fucking, to my channel. But sometimes shit just needs to be spoken on, you know, and I just, now that's a story for another time. I could tell that story in like one video. That's a video within itself, those situations. It happened on three different occasions, twice in 2016. Actually, I think it was once in 2015 or 16, and it happened two more times throughout the end of 2016. So it was just like some weird shit. And I could get into that. Maybe some other time I'll talk about that. But this, again, this video is in response to all the bullshit that I'm seeing on social media from these racist-ass, ignorant motherfucking white people that are on there. And again, if you feel like you are not one of these white people who have a problem with black people or anything like that, then you shouldn't feel offended for me saying these things, but you should understand why it needs to be said, because these motherfuckers out here are running rampant right now. It's like when Donald Trump got in office, it's like this, they just ripped the shirt off their chest just to expose their ass, like super racist, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, they just went into extra mode, and they all fucking over. And even though I do a good job with ignoring it, this is probably like the first and only time I'm going to actually address it, but it, something needed to be said. And, you know, the first couple times I tried to do this video, I messed up. I tried to, you know, do it to the best of my abilities this time. Because my brain, again, even though science says that the brain processes processes information faster than your mouth can speak it, my mind is just like, because there's so much information in there, not to toot my own horn, because I hate doing that. Like, I don't like tooting my own horn. But my brain, because I like to study random things. You know what I mean? Like slavery, again, like Rococo fashion, like a design for those dresses back then. That's how I know it was modeled after black women, even though I didn't really pull that up. You know, that's how I know about buck breaking, and, you know, black men were sodomized. What they would do is they would take the most respected black man out the group, and basically they would fuck him in the ass, because at that time it was seen as a sign of domination. And so people are actually right when they say, yeah, you know what, I'm not going to get into it. But it was a way to instill fear into the rest of the slaves, basically. And it was to show domination over that person, you know. And, you know what I'm saying? And I didn't touch on it, but I guess I'll just throw it in there. It's random, because I think I missed the point where it would be best to bring this in. Back when I was talking about Zoe Saldana, she's married. I don't know if she's still married to him. I think she is. But she's married to an Italian white man. Now, the only white people who actually would have an argument that they aren't racist would be the working class whites. That would be the Irish, those who are of Irish descent, Italian descent, as well as, I think, Eastern European, I want to say. Because I know Eastern and Western Europe, they were kind of like divided between like the slums and like the rich neighborhoods. I think Western Europe was like the rich part of the country, and like Eastern Europe was like the slums, kind of. But more so like the Italians and the Irish, they were like working hand in hand with the black people, and they created unions and things like that. But then over time, because being white meant that you had wealth and you had all these great things, they actually persuaded the Irish and the Italian immigrants to join the white cause, you know what I mean? And that's when slavery took the biggest turn for the worse right there. So Italians and Irishes and Eastern Europeans, like, they were tricked into fighting the white man's war when they weren't considered to be white. They actually got comics out where they were actually making fun of the Irish and Italian immigrants the same way they had comics out making fun of the black people. You know what I'm saying? So it's funny that she married a white dude from Italy, you know. But I don't know, but yeah, so again, this is just in response to all the bullshit that I'm seeing online. I hope I did a good enough job to get everything I wanted to say out. I guess I'll know based on the response. Like I said, if I lose any friends because of this, you know, I guess you were never my friend in the first place. I don't have anything against people who get along with blacks. But for the ones who don't, this was in response to them. You know what I mean? So that's basically what this video is for. And I just got so sick of seeing it that I felt like I had to say something. So hopefully I did a good enough job, you know. So thank you guys for watching. Peace. And that's it. It's over. You know what I'm saying? So why do you think white people want to feel oppressed? I wish I could have brought up some of those tweets so that you guys could see what I'm talking about, but fuck it, man. The video's over. It's done. Thanks for watching. I love you all.